So the verse for today was, for this reason this child will be well known in the world as one who is protected by the personality of Godhead. O most fortunate one, there is no doubt that this child will become a first-class devotee and will be qualified with all good qualities. Prabhupada makes here in the purport this very important distinction between the three types of devotees. And this is so important because this is a checklist. Speak louder. If you can't hear me, you have to come closer. this distinction between the three types of devotees, or three classes of devotees, as Prabhupada calls us, is so important because it is a checklist for us to understand where we are in spiritual life, where how Krishna conscious we are. It says that the beginners in Krishna consciousness, the Kanishta Adhikaris, or as Prabhupada calls it here, the materialistic devotees. That's very important. I'll talk about that a little more. The materialistic devotees, they come to the temple, they offer their respect to Krishna, they worship Krishna, but they don't see anything having a relationship to Krishna besides them and the deity. They don't understand that there are other devotees also. They don't understand that there are other living beings who also have a relationship with Krishna that might be similar to their own or might be different from their own. So therefore, they are called materialistic devotees because they make a very clear distinction between this is Krishna and everything else is material. Nothing else has a relation to Krishna, or nothing else is Krishna than the deity, and therefore I only reciprocate with Krishna through the deity. There is no Krishna anywhere else. But we hear in Bhagavad Gita that Krishna is present in this world in three very distinct forms. Somebody knows in which ways Krishna is present in this world? Anyone has an idea?
I know the five forms, but three I don't know.
Well, actually it's more than three, but I want to talk about the three types of presence Krishna is having. Yeah. Exactly. Krishna is present in this world through his Brahman energy, which is all-pervading, that means he's everywhere. But not in a personal sense, just his energy, his power, his strength. But then he's personally present as Paramatma in everyone's heart. And then he appears as Bhagavan, as his full person. And on top of that, he also appears, of course, in the deity form, and he appears in the holy name, which is non-different from his person. The holy name is not non-different from the Brahman, or not non-different from the Paramatma. The holy name is non-different from Bhagavan, from Krishna, from his whole person. And Krishna appears in the form of the Bhagavatam, and he appears in the form of the Bhagavat devotee, of the pure devotee of the Lord. He appears in the form of Prasad. So, therefore, a beginner devotee is called materialistic because he doesn't understand much at all. Because when we think about this, Krishna is everywhere, all the time, in so many different ways. And to not be aware of this, and not to even consider this, this is really a very, very beginning stage of consciousness. But nonetheless, and this is also important, one should not be arrogant and think, oh well, I know so much more than this already, so I'm definitely not in this category, and look at those third class devotees, no value. They're not any good. No, Krishna sees this very differently. It says here that a devotee who may be in any of these categories is automatically qualified by all good qualities. So even the third grade devotee is a devotee. So we should be respectful to him. Krishna certainly is very grateful to his service. Even though there might be some flaws, some lack of understanding, maybe even some offenses because of this lack of understanding, still Krishna only sees the good in us. So even for a third-class devotee who is a very beginner in spiritual life, who does not understand much, Krishna is just overwhelmed with love for this devotee. Because he's trying to be a devotee. He's offering some service, some respect, some worship. Prabhupada said all of us in ISKCON, all ISKCON members, should at least be second-class devotees. Prabhupada was a realist. He knew that not everybody would become a Mahabhagavat, a pure devotee of Krishna. Although he says anyone can be. He said you can be a pure devotee in 1 second. In one blink of an eye you can become a pure devotee. It's that easy. But it's also not that easy. We know. The influence of the material energy is overwhelming in this world. So although we might have a short flicker of pure devotion in our heart for a short moment, it usually comes and goes. That's also one of the qualities of a second-class devotee, that he is not fully steady yet in his devotional service. He's performing service sincerely, but sometimes he does and sometimes he doesn't. And that's where most of us are. Sometimes we do service, sometimes we don't do service. Sometimes we engage in the service to our senses, to our mind, to our false ego, not in the service of the Lord. So our service is not steady yet, it's coming and going. And usually when we have either intense happiness or intense distress, that's when we don't do service. That's when we seek shelter in what we already know from our past experience. Who, when we get something very nice in our life, something very joyful, when we have a very happy experience, thinks, oh, now let me serve Krishna. This is Krishna's gift to me. Let me do something special now for him as a sign of gratitude. Most of us, we just enjoy the moment, right? Or when we are in deep difficulties, you know, something difficult happens. We lose our job, or get sick, a family member gets sick, or some other calamity happens. Yes, sometimes we say, oh, Krishna, please help me. But what do we do practically? Usually we seek shelter in the things that we already know from our past experience. Either some not so healthy behaviors, or we turn to sense gratification, balance the bad with the good. Oh, I feel sad, so let me eat something, or I feel sad, so let me go shopping, or let me watch some TV, or listen to some music. When we are sad, when do we take our japas when we feel sad and say, oh, now let me really chant? Most of us, we think that, oh, I have to be in a certain mental state, then I can sit down and chant, right? I should be peaceful in my head, I should not be stressed, I should have some time to chant, then I can sit and chant. And if I don't have all these conditions, no, then I don't do it now, I'll do it later. So those are all symptoms of a devotee who is not steady yet in devotional service. But we should come at least to the stage of second class devotee in a sense that we develop this understanding that Prabhupada is explaining here, that we have a mentality of genuine service. What does that mean? That we don't just serve out of a ritualistic idea. Oh yes, every morning I should offer some flower. I don't know why I'm doing it, and I don't know who I'm doing it for, but it's just what I do. Or I always clap my hands 3 times before I eat, or I ring the bell, say some mantra. But in my heart there's nothing. A genuine mentality of genuine service means what I do, I really want to do for Krishna. I want to do this to please Krishna, to please the devotees of Krishna. To really have some idea of what I'm doing. That's what it means. And of course, to be able to have that idea of what I'm doing, we have to know a little bit philosophy, have a little bit of association so we know what's what. And such a devotee makes friendships with other devotees and shows his favor to beginners and avoids the atheists. Something that Rupa Goswami explains in the Nectar of Instruction, that as a devotee, on a second level, we should try to associate, spend our free time, spend our time, get our social well-being and so on from other devotees. Why? Because in this association, naturally the topic of Krishna will come up again and again. Maybe not all the time, you know. There are also practical things one does and one talks about, but even if such things are done with devotees, somehow there will always be Krishna involved. So friendships that are so important should be made with devotees, preferably, if possible. As Hare Krishnas, we often think that means that all other friendships have to be rejected. All my friends that I already have, I should reject them. Is that so? Do you think is that a good thing? Martin?
No, I would not say so, because we also have, like brothers, we also have the opportunity like to share ideas and to show the people a certain perspective. Also.
Yes. We have the opportunity and actually we have the responsibility as devotees to show kindness to other living beings. So our friendships that we have cultivated previously can take a different quality. Should use them as an opportunity to show kindness to others, to offer guidance maybe. And especially in real friendships, that is an opportunity. Not with some acquaintances, you know, some drinking buddies from our previous life or somebody we just go to the football matches with, you know. And then otherwise we don't share anything. Those relationships, they are, you know, there's not much depth usually. It's difficult to, one can show a good example, but usually that good example is perceived as something negative by the others. At least that's the experience I had. Some school friends with whom I was skateboarding and just hanging out and doing nonsense. When I stopped drinking alcohol, when I started chanting, they rejected me as a friend because I was not fun anymore. Of course, maybe I was a little bit fanatic as a teenager, that might be, but still, you know, the relationship didn't have much depth, so there was not much to work with. But true friendships, people that we are friends with, that we share things with, that we are open with, in those relationships we have an opportunity to show kindness. And as Martin said, to share ideas, to give an example, so we can help others develop their Krishna consciousness. It does not mean that we have to be preachy, you know, give them a lecture. But just be a good friend. Just like when your friend is sick and you have the medicine, wouldn't you want to give that friend the medicine that you have? That's the idea, that's the mentality. And at the same time, such a devotee, a second-class devotee, he's guiding the beginners, others who are very new in Krishna consciousness, by his example. Again, not from a position of superiority, but from a position of a genuine mentality of service. It is my service. I'm trying to serve the other devotees by guiding them in Krishna consciousness, by showing them something. Prabhupada gave the absolutely perfect description of what this kind of mentality feels like. Once he was in Stockholm giving a class in the university auditorium, and this was in the early 70s, and students were quite revolutionary at that time, and they still do, but not as much anymore. Back then they had a big problem with authorities. Authority figures were hated. Everything was supposed to be democratic, you know, everybody's equal. So there, Prabhupada sits on stage and the devotees had arranged a huge Vyasasana. Not something modest like Prabhupada has here in our temple. It was like 1.5-2 meters high on top of the stage. So Prabhupada was sitting there on a throne, you know, big, big seat. And he was talking, and he was talking also about the different types of devotees, similar topic he was talking about. And then he was talking about the varnas also. And one student, he interrupted him and he shouted, "So who do you think you are? You think you're a first class person? You're the best?" And Prabhupada said, "No, I'm the fifth class person, I'm the lowest, because I'm the servant of everyone." This is how a devotee feels. I'm everyone's servant. This is true humility. Externals might differ from one person to the other. Externals might also differ in our relationships. With some people we have a relationship of authority. With some we have a relationship of service, servitude. And with some we have a relationship of equal friendship. But in all these types of relationships, the mentality of the devotee is, I'm everyone's servant. Service in different ways, but I'm always everyone's servant. And this is also how a second-class devotee, a Madhyama Adhikari, is treating the beginners. Not from a position of pride, of superiority, but from a position of humility and service. Giving them guidance with this mentality. Otherwise, becomes very disgusting. And we see this, you know, in our little social experiment that we call ISKCON, that, you know, when devotees feel superior to others, oh, this is very, very terrible. Everybody feels unhappy. Such a disturbance. But if everybody is having a humble attitude, humbly listening to others and humbly speaking to others, then the association is becoming very, very wonderful. So, and finally, a Madhyama Adhikari, he is avoiding the atheists, avoiding those who are opposed to Krishna. Not the agnostics. That's something also we often mix up as devotees. No? Because we don't have a clear understanding what an atheist really is. Or most of us think that everyone who does not believe in God, he is an atheist. So we should avoid them all. But actually most people, they are not atheists. Most people who say, I don't believe in God, they're agnostics. They just don't accept, they don't believe in the existence of a Supreme Personality, but they're not opposed. They don't say, there is a God and I hate him. An atheist is really, he accepts there's a God, but he's against God. He's turning against God. He doesn't say, oh, I don't know if there is a God or not. I don't know. I don't believe. Such a person can change their attitude or change, be convinced, you know, be shown that God exists. But a person who says, yes, there is God, but I hate him. This is the true atheistic mentality. And that such people one should avoid, because there is no common ground on anything. And they just disturb us. They disturb a devotee's service, because they are opposed to God, and therefore they are also opposed to God's devotees. They want to stop people from doing service. I had this experience once. I was distributing books in Munich, and there was a person posing as a member of another religious group. I'm not going to say which one, but actually he was an atheist, because he was standing behind me and trying to scare the people that I was approaching with books. Grr, like such faces. And people were, you know, I didn't know first what was happening. People were, you know, they were looking at me, and then they were like, eh? And then at some point I realized that there was this person behind me, and I was like, what's going on? And I just ignored him, you know. First I told him, go away, and he was like, saying something. I just ignored him and kept distributing books. And some people did stop, and I talked to them, and then he jumped next to us, like, you should stop this, you know. This is the devil. Go away. He was telling to the person who I approached, not to me, to the other person. He was trying to scare them away. I guess in his head he was trying to save them from me. I don't know. So, a true devotee recognizes service to Krishna, to God, in whatever way it comes, whatever religious form it takes, whatever cultural background it has. But somebody who thinks that, you know, I should stop this service. No, this is not good. This is actually true atheistic behavior. No matter what you call yourself. So, such people one should avoid, because there's just nothing one can do. No good example will help. No arguments will help. No humble attitude will help. Nothing. So, and then of course there's the pure devotee. And the pure devotee, this is what we should all aim for, what we should strive for, the kind of mentality we should develop. And it is something that has to come from the heart. It's not something that we can develop intellectually. A pure devotee, he sees Krishna everywhere all the time, in every encounter he has with another person, in every relationship he has. In everything he experiences, he sees Krishna. If the wind is blowing in his face, he will feel, oh, this is the breath of Krishna. If he's touched by the sunlight, he will feel, oh, this is Krishna's warmth. If he talks to somebody about whatever, paying the electricity bill, he will see Krishna in that. If he has experience with nasty people, he will see Krishna as, oh, thank you, he was teaching me humility. Such a person sees everyone as a devotee of Krishna. Everyone. Not just the ones who outwardly serve Krishna, but everyone is a devotee of Krishna, because everyone is. Even the ones who don't know it yet, they are also devotees of Krishna. Every single living entity in this material world is a devotee of Krishna. Just not everyone is aware of it and acts accordingly. But we all are. That is our nature. So a pure devotee, a Mahabhagavat, sees things according to their true nature, not according to their external dress. We usually judge people by the clothes they wear or the hairdress or whatever. You might think, no, I don't do that. But just imagine an 80-year-old woman dressing like a 12-year-old teenager. You would think, this is very strange, isn't it? Just looks inappropriate. Or some of us have trouble with men dressing like women. Cross-dressers or gender fluidity is such a difficult topic for many people nowadays. They feel threatened by it. Because why? We judge people on their external appearance. So a devotee, a pure devotee, he sees beyond all of that and further. He doesn't think, oh, this is a man, a woman, a German, an animal, a bird, a tree. He sees everyone by their true nature as a devotee of Krishna. So we might also think like this sometimes, because we hear this so much. We read about it so much. So intellectually we have this understanding, maybe, and we have some of that knowledge, maybe. But do we feel like it? Is this a natural way of existence for us to perceive the world around us this way? Not yet. So you can't become a pure devotee just by intellectual strength, just by intellectual exercise, just by philosophical consideration. You do not become a pure devotee. All this will help you as a second-class devotee, because you build the philosophical basis. But then, to be a pure devotee, this knowledge becomes realized knowledge. It becomes your reality. And actually, it's not your reality. You start to perceive the eternal spiritual reality. You perceive the eternal spiritual reality. Your view of the world is changing 180 degrees. And this is not something we can just train ourselves to do. We can train ourselves to build the foundation for this. So how do we become a second-class devotee, at least? By keeping the association with the devotees, hearing the Bhagavatam, chanting the holy name, taking prasadam, staying in a holy place. The holy place is where the names of the Lord are chanted. Because all these things will cultivate a deep spiritual understanding in our heart. These things cultivate a deep spiritual understanding in our heart. And therefore this genuine mentality of service is growing, is developing in our heart. And then, when this genuine mentality of service becomes our natural state of existence, by further going deeper and deeper in our chanting, in our service, in our understanding, our heart becomes purified. Then the real process of bhakti is taking hold. Purification of the heart. Because what is a pure devotee? It is a devotee like you and me, but with a pure heart. That's the difference. The quality of the heart, it means the quality of the consciousness. And the quality of the consciousness improves by following the process of bhakti. With a proper understanding, with a proper attitude. Why you can't jump from third to first class devotee? Because on the second level of devotional service, the purification really takes place. Why? Because you have a genuine mentality, the proper attitude, and also some knowledge. So what you do really takes effect. That's why Agyata Sukriti, what the first class devotee usually gets, doesn't do so much. Agyata Sukriti means some unconscious spiritual advancement. Like some person on the street hears the holy name somewhere. How come this person is not becoming a pure devotee in the next second? Or some person who eats at Ratha Yatra prasadam cookie, how come he doesn't faint in ecstasy and for the rest of his life just chants the holy name continuously? Why is that? Because a process of purification of the heart has to take place. But that process only takes place when we are conscious and when we are aware of what we are doing, when we are aware of the cleaning process. Everything before that is also a cleaning process, but it only leads us to the point where we become aware of what's happening. Because once we are aware of what is happening in our heart, we really go deep. We really go at it. It's like Lord Chaitanya gave this example of the mirror covered in dust. So Agyata Sukriti is when you have a really dirty mirror covered with like a thick layer of dust. Agyata Sukriti is like blowing a little bit. Some dust comes off. And you do this a long time. But when you have like a really dirty surface, you know, when you have a dirty surface, you can blow off a lot of dust and dirt, but it's still not really clean. So what do you have to do then? You have to scrub. And then after you're done scrubbing, what do you do then? You polish. And you polish, and you polish until it's perfect. Until it's a perfect surface. And this you do consciously. This does not happen automatically, unconsciously. Because you have to be aware, oh, I missed a little spot here. You can't be careless when you clean. Like, okay, done. No, actually not done. We know this sometimes when we clean the pots in Krishna's kitchen. No? We do, done. And then we look again and say, oh, here we missed a spot, and there's a spot, and there's some crust. And no. So you have to be conscious, you have to be aware of what you're doing. And this only happens on the second level. Therefore, the second level is so important. Therefore, Prabhupada wanted us to become a second great devotee. Because there we start to consciously perform the process of bhakti and really work towards becoming a pure devotee. And this might take our entire life, according to our karma, according to our capabilities, according to our sincerity. But it can happen in a second. If we are sincere, with Krishna's help, it can happen in any second. And with this knowledge that it can happen any second, we should stay enthusiastic. Just go in. Just one more moment. I keep going. Just one more moment. One more moment. One more moment. And we will see the effects of it. We will see that we actually do develop a mentality of genuine service, and this will be the source of all the joy in our life. Because serving others is what really makes us happy. Serving ourselves is like scratching an itch. Some short-term gratification, but there is no real happiness. Isn't it when you have a mosquito bite and it itches, you scratch a little bit and there's some relief. But it did not give you deep joy, real happiness. Afterwards you're back in a state of neutrality, just the sensation is gone. Or what often we do, we scratch a little too much and then it starts hurting. Instead of itching sometimes, it's hurting all the time. That's what we often do in material life. You know? We like something and then we overdo it until it creates problems for us. That's what we call addiction, for example. Or overeating. Feel sick after eating. There's a little too much enjoyment there. But this does not give us real happiness, real sense of satisfaction, of fulfillment. This we only get from service to others. Why? Because service is an expression of love. So we are in our natural state. We are settled in our true nature. A loving being, a loving eternal being, So when we serve others, we are acting out our eternal nature, and therefore we feel satisfied, we will happy. We are ourselves. Do you maybe have some questions, comments, some doubts? Or? Yeah, Martin.
Yeah, I have a question. Like, how can we get like rid of this constant rating, like in our minds, like when we are in certain circumstances, like for example, I especially experience this now. When like, people are smoking and you're thinking, like for example when I go for a run or something and you run around and like then it's the person smoking and it's like for me it's like very disgusting and I feel it in my lungs. It's not so nice for my body and my mind directly goes like, oh why do they have to smoke and what good brings this for the world how can I get rid of this? Like rating of other people's also behavior.
That's the nature of the mind. The mind has two functions, to like and to dislike. That's the only way it operates. I like this, I don't like that. I like this person, I don't like that person. So we cannot get rid of it. That's what the mind is. We can't be mindless. Then we would be quite dull. But what can we do? Krishna explains in Bhagavad Gita what we can do. He gives this analogy of a chariot. Maybe you know this, it's also a famous picture. The soul on the chariot with the horses that are the senses. And the interesting thing is the driver is the mind, right? And the reins is the intelligence, isn't it? Or is it the other way around? I always forget. Or the driver is the intelligence and the reins is the mind. I would have to look it up now.
The horse is the senses.
Now I'm confused. So where's the mind? Okay, we have to look it up, the analogy. But the point is, how do we control our senses and our mind? Through our intelligence. So by developing a strong intelligence, you can control your mind. The mind will always do this. It will never stop doing it. But you can train yourself how you react on it, because you are not your mind. You can perceive it and choose to ignore it. Or you can perceive it and choose to act in a way that is guided by your strong intelligence. So in your example of being annoyed with people smoking, I completely share that thought. That's also one of the things that annoys me the most, people smoking. You can feel, you can wish them well. You can feel compassion to them. A Vaishnava has compassion to others. What does it mean? He feels compassion to somebody who is wasting his life, wasting his health, wasting his money, and wish him well. And because we don't like to inhale it, we avoid it as much as possible. Don't have to stay in their proximity. So also when you're running, yes, sometimes it's unavoidable, just like we breathe in the fumes of the car, but we can try to create circumstances for ourselves where we avoid it.
The soul is the driver.
Uh-huh.
The chariot is intelligence.
Ah, okay.
The reins are the mind.
The reins are the mind, okay. So the chariot is the intelligence and the reins is the mind with which we control the senses. So, like with the reins on a horse, you have to hold them tight, otherwise the horse runs wherever it wants. And how do you do this? It's connected to the chariot, to you. So the intelligence is the what actually gives you the strength to control your mind. So, how to get rid of this? You cannot get rid of it. The mind will always like and dislike things. And you see this. This function even appears in Krishna conscious context. Oh, I don't like this prasadam. I like that prasadam. Mm-hmm. I don't like this flower. I like that flower. I don't like the smell of this incense. I like the smell of that incense. I don't like this kirtan. I like that kirtan. The mind will always do it, no matter what the circumstances. But we have to keep it under control. Through our intelligence, we have to keep it under control. So we are not following the mind wherever it goes right now. Because once we start just without control, acting according to whatever the mind is saying right now, then we lose all self-control. To be the servant of the mind is to be constantly doing something else. And in this might be, you know, that you start yelling at the person, hey, why are you smoking, you know? Don't disturb me. That might be one of the reactions if the mind is disturbed. Oh, I don't like this. Then you act accordingly. I don't like this. You become aggressive to that person or condescending. And yes, first it's a thought, but then usually people who don't control their mind with intelligence, they act their thoughts, they act them out. So, how do we develop a strong intelligence? By giving our intelligence good spiritual nourishment. By developing a good spiritual foundation of knowledge, so we know what's what. And in this case it means understanding this is a conditioned soul who doesn't really know what he's doing. He's not doing anything good to himself and not doing good to others. But I should feel compassion to that person. And I should have compassion to myself and not put myself in harm's way if possible.
Was ich habe mir noch dazu wrote down to this point is like how can I then stay humble in the state of mind and not going like this person is smoking and I'm so stupid and like thinking yourself okay I have the knowledge I'm smarter like somehow I often have the feeling then I feel myself on a higher level but I don't want to.
Well, it's okay to understand that I have a higher understanding than others. But again, how do you feel towards the person? Do you feel like, oh, what an idiot? He's such an idiot. Such a stupid person. But I'm not. Thank God I'm not. Or do you feel sorry for the person? It's very different. Do you have compassion? Do you have mitleid for that person? Or do you just think, what an idiot? So we can try to develop compassion to others. Feel sorry for them. And maybe at this moment there's nothing we can do for them besides giving a short prayer. Krishna, please, you're also the super soul in his heart. You're not just in the heart of the nice, friendly vegans. You're also in the heart of the gross, cruel meat eaters. You're also the super soul in the butcher. You're the super soul in the one who's beating his wife. You're the super soul in the child who is carelessly hurting other animals. You're the super soul in the drug addict. You're the super soul in everyone's heart. So we can always pray, Krishna, please show this person, be kind to this person. Please enlighten this person. Please give him some understanding. Please help this person. I might not be able to. Because we are not in the position to help many people. Our circle of influence is very small. But we can always pray. So maybe that's a nice thought. Instead of thinking, oh, what an idiot. What is he doing with himself and with the world and with me? Think, oh Krishna, please help this person. Yeah, Krishna.
Drunkards who lit a cigarette and started smoking, and then the was like a division, non-smoking area and smoking area. And then stewardess came to them, they put the cigarette down, and then because they were drunk, after a few minutes, they lit the cigarette again, and then the servant went, tried to get up, and Prabhupada asked him, where are you going? And he said, well, they're smoking again, I will call the stewardess. And he said, in a deep voice, he said, sit down. And he said, what is the difference then between us and them if we cannot tolerate it? And he was absolutely calm, and he was tolerating and very humble about it. And when I get disturbed when someone smokes in the stops, tram stops or something, I always remember this story. It really helps me to calm down. And another servant also told the same similar story to this one, and their Prabhupada made the point of humility that we don't own the world, we share it, and you know, everyone is in it. And so then I always try to tell these two points to myself. Be patient and be humble. Because Prabhupada showed the example of the Vaishnava in this exactly this topic. I like the story.
Yeah. And of course we can keep our distance if possible. Thank you. Any other questions or comments?
I think it's important to understand the difference between the sin and the sinner. Because the as you said, the man is just addicted, I don't know. So he had some karmic problems or issues or so on, but it's not he. So he's the soul.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's interesting.
Yeah. Exactly. Something good to always keep in mind about everyone.
Very hard. Very hard.
I don't like what you do, but it doesn't mean I don't like you.
Because you are not similar with the things you do, because you have some history.
Yeah.
And to ask others about this history, why are they so now? Something sometimes very interesting. Because there is some.
Yeah.
And then I can say for myself, I see that there is really a person behind this whole appearance.
Exactly. We all come with a story. There's nothing we do without a cause in this life. That's common. Everything is cause and effect, so whatever we do has a reason. And also our bad behaviors, our shortcomings, they all have a reason. No, as you say, once we try to discover them, we can try to fix them also.
And maybe it's a possibility to understand another one, or to try to understand the way to come to today, and to have some mitlike?
Compassion.
Compassion
to this
soul.
Exactly. Yep.
It's hard. Sometimes.
That's why it must be important. All right. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.